एक्चुअल में मतलब रेट टैक्स में फर्क है ना।
अच्छा हाँ, इसके अंदर एग्जाम भी तो इंक्लूड है। ठीक है, टैक्स देख लीजिए, टैक्स तो करोगे या नहीं, फिर उधर तो टैक्स आता नहीं है। अगर इसका टाइम बैठ गया 4,000, 4529, हाँ
कितना आया आपका?
बैठ गया है, फिर ही बैठा है।
हेलो,
गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन, वेरी वार्म वेलकम टू ऑल द मेंबर्स टू दिस मीटिंग, फर्स्ट मीटिंग ऑफ दिसंबर। वेल, वी हैव अ वेरी यूनिक टॉपिक टुडे विद रिस्पेक्ट टू जीएसटी, वेयर ऑल आवर लीगेसी जजमेंट्स व्हिच आर गोइंग टू अफेक्ट अंडर द जीएसटी एक्ट आर गोइंग टू बी डिस्कस्ड विद। वेल, वी हैव न्यूज टुडे, आवर अर्लियर स्पीकर मिस्टर जतिन हरजाई एडवोकेट इज नॉट अवेलेबल बिकॉज ही इज अनवेल, एंड वी आर very much thankful to our current speaker Vishal Poddar, who actually has taken up just this today morning, and he has agreed to take up a session and he has taken up the slides. He calls himself a student of GST. He has in fact patented this, but we are your students, sir. Now we would like to be your student, and very frankly, in such a short time taking up this session, I think BCSE is very much grateful to you, and we'll never forget this gesture from your end. And today we are meeting online. Hopefully, in some time we'll surely call you offline to come
Please,
here
my pleasure.
And meet our members in person, so that we can implicate your gesture by meeting you in person. I would like to request Shreyas to start the institute motto before we start our proceedings.
So we will start the motto first.
Yaeshasupteshu jagrati.
Friends, as per the institute guidelines, we also have some investor awareness jingles to play. So we will just play that.
QICI for Tax and Finance Literacy Drive. Finally, funnels of tax and finance are clear to me.
Lots of housewives, employees, doctors, students, entrepreneurs, farmers, and people from other categories are learning the funnels, saving, budgeting, investing, and spending after participating in ICAI's Tax and Finance Drive. You too participate and become self-reliant by learning about finance and tax guidance from expert chartered accountants. Vittiya Gyan, ICAI's initiative. Visit icai.org.
QICAI for Tax and Finance Literacy Drive. फाइनली मुझे टैक्स और फाइनेंस के फंडिंग क्लियर हो रहे हैं।
ढेरों हाउसवाइफ्स, एम्प्लॉइज, डॉक्टर्स, स्टूडेंट्स, एंटरप्रेन्योर्स, फार्मर्स और अन्य श्रेणी के लोग ICAI के फाइनेंशियल एंड टैक्स लिटरेसी ड्राइव का हिस्सा बनकर सेविंग्स, बजटिंग, इन्वेस्टिंग और स्पेंडिंग के फंडे सीख रहे हैं। आप भी हिस्सा बनिए और एक्सपर्ट चार्टर्ड अकाउंटेंट से फाइनेंस और टैक्स गाइडेंस सीख कर आत्मनिर्भर बनिए। वित्तीय ज्ञान ICAI का अभियान। विजिट ICAI.org।
धन्यवाद ICAI टैक्स आणि फायनान्स लिटरसी ड्राइव साठी। फायनली माझे टॅक्स आणि फायनान्स चे फंडे क्लिअर होत आहे।
असंख्य गृहिणी, एम्प्लॉईज, डॉक्टर्स, स्टुडंट्स, उद्योजक, शेतकरी आणि अन्य श्रेणीचे लोक ICAI च्या फायनान्शियल आणि टॅक्स लिटरसी ड्राइव्हचा भाग बनून सेव्हिंग, बजेटिंग, गुंतवणूक आणि खर्चाचे फंडे शिकत आहेत। आपणही एक भाग बना आणि एक्सपर्ट चार्टर्ड अकाउंटंट्स कडून फायनान्स आणि कर मार्गदर्शनाद्वारे प्लॅनिंग शिकून आत्मनिर्भर बना। वित्तीय ज्ञान ICAI च अभियान। હિસ્સો બની અને સ્પેન્ડિંગ ના ફંડા શીખી રહ્યા છે। તમે પણ હિસ્સો બનવો અને એક્સપર્ટ ચાર્ટર્ડ એકાઉન્ટન્ટ પાસેથી ફાઇનાન્સ અને ટેક્સ ગાઈડન્સ શીખીને આત્મનિર્ભર બનો। વિત્તીય જ્ઞાન ICAI નું અભિયાન। Visit ICAI.org.
Thank you, friends. Over to you, Pradeep bhai.
Thank you, Shreyas bhai, for the customary proceedings. Well, as discussed some time ago, we have a very unique topic today. I just would like to request all the members to post the questions in the Q&A box only and not in the chat box. And without wasting much time, I would like to request Shreyas bhai to introduce our today's speaker, CA Vishal Poddar.
Sure. Thank you, Pradeep bhai. Friends, before I proceed with the introduction for the speaker for the day, we also present our gratitude by way of e-momentum to CA Jatin Harjai, who could not make to the session today. So we appreciate him for his efforts until last moment. And now I'll introduce the speaker for the day. So, friends, today we have CA Vishal Poddar with us to take us through the topic for the day. He is a qualified chartered accountant working as a partner with SS Mutha & Company in tax and assurance practice with special focus on indirect taxes. He is empaneled as a GST trainer by ICAI. He is a faculty for GST officer at NACIN, regular speaker at various professional forums, developed GST audit module. Is expertised in business process reengineering to develop models for aligning GST, income tax, and Ind AS compliances. With this brief introduction, I would request CA Vishal Poddarji to proceed with his presentation. Thank you, sir, for coming.
Welcome, Vishal. Welcome.
Thank you, Shreyas ji, for very nice introduction of me, and thank you, Dushyant bhai, for this great opportunity. I thank the entire team for putting things in place. It is not easy nowadays to organize and manage these sessions, but I'm thankful that I am part of this August gathering. So members, let us take up the topic. The topic assigned to me today by the members of our team is to deliberate upon legacy issues and how these issues can help us in the entire GST practice. Now, I would try to take up certain issues. My initial presentation would be dealing with those issues which you may not have been handling presently, but I'm sure in near future, these would be something which would be of great help to you. And then in the next part of my deliberation, I'll be taking up those issues which I'm sure day in, day out, we are receiving notices and we require some backup to handle those notices. So with this brief introduction, I again welcome all the members, the learned members of this great Borivali Central CP Study Circle. And the topic assigned to me today is legacy case studies. So starting with the topic, first, I'd like to share a very interesting point that whenever I study, I research, I always try to link right from my early CA days. I try to link whatever new concepts I study with whatever I know. And generally, I'm very much inclined to our tradition. So I try to link it with something in our tradition. So on these lines, we have a very important concept in our Indian tradition that is of Tridevas. And there is an interesting link between the taxation and Trideva, how that we are going to understand. But before that, I also personally believe that the Western philosophy of God is nothing but the personification of our concept of Trideva. How? G-O-D, God, is not a name given to the Almighty. I believe it is an abbreviation of Trideva, where G stands for generator, that is Brahma. O is organizer, that is Vishnu. And D is destroyer, that is Shiva. So I'm sure that whenever next time you hear this word God, you will remember our Trideva that Western people have simply tried to copy. Now, how this concept is applicable even in taxation? In taxation, the role of Brahma is played by the parliament, who is the lawmaker. And in case of GST, we can also say it is the GST council. The role of Vishnu is played by we, the consultants, because our role is most important in bridging the gap between the law and the portal. So our role is to implement the law in its true spirits. And from the government side, it is the departmental officials who play this role. Then comes the most important role in this today's GST, since it is in a very infancy stage. Many things have yet to be interpreted. Many things require amendment. Many things need to be struck down. And this role is played by the honorable judiciary. So this is how the concept of Trideva is also applicable to our taxation subject. Now we start with our today's deliberation, where the first concept on which I will be deliberating upon is the concept of willful misstatement or suppression of facts. We are yet to receive any judgments under the GST law with relation to this concept, but this has a lot of relevance in GST. How? As we all know, broadly, the actions nowadays initiated are under section 73 and rather more commonly under 74. I will really request members that whenever you receive any notice under section 74, it is very important to first check whether the notice satisfies all the requirement of section 74. And one of the very important requirement is that this particular section can be used by the department only when the department has believed that tax has not been paid, short paid, erroneously refunded, or ITC is wrongly availed. But what is very important is all this should have happened by reason of fraud or any willful misstatement or suppression of facts. Now, until and unless this component is missing, that there is a reason of fraud or willful misstatement or suppression of fact, the department cannot initiate action under section 74. Now, many times proving fraud is difficult. So the easy recourse that this department people are resorting to is resorting to the concept of willful misstatement or suppression. So I thought that let me touch upon this particular point so that in future, if you're handling this particular issue, this particular point could be of great use. Now, subsection one says that where it appears to the proper officer that there is some short payment, etc., and it is by reason of fraud or willful misstatement or suppression of fact, then section 74 applies and the recourse can be had to this section. Now, interestingly, there is an explanation added to this section 74 defining what could be the meaning of this particular term. It says that for the purpose of this act, and not only this section, it is for the purpose of the entire act, the expression suppression shall mean non-declaration of facts or information which a taxable person is required to declare. Now, this is something which I personally believe is wrongly interpreted. I don't know whether I should use the word, but it is wrongly interpreted by the department officials that they are going by the verbatim of this particular explanation, where by simply non-declaring anything in statements like your GSTR 1 or 3B, they are taking recourse to section 74. But here I would like to add one simple point, dear members. Please note that the section reads like this. It says that any of these things has happened by reason of fraud. For the time being, we are keeping fraud aside. Or it is willful misstatement or suppression of facts. Now, the point is, the question of dispute is whether this willful precedes only misstatement or whether it also precedes suppression of facts. I personally understand that the word willful misstatement precedes both. It is willful misstatement or also willful suppression of facts. And once this can be established, I believe that we can get out of notice of section 74. Yes, maximum they can go to section 73, but which has then much better provisions from the side of the registered persons. So this is what brings me to our today's deliberation of the topic on this particular legacy case of Cosmic Dye Chemicals. Now, to understand this particular case, let us first go to the facts of the case. The assessee, the appellant, is engaged in manufacturing of two types of dyes, The names are there, Rapidogen and Naphthol. Secondly, most important, Rapidogen was exempt by virtue of notification. Now, for Naphthol, that is the taxable item, again, there was an exemption notification. Now, I'm sure you all would be knowing that in the pre-GST era of excise, there were various exemption notifications, one of which we commonly know is also called as SSI exemption notification, which was based on turnover. Similar to that, in this particular notification, it is a very old notification of 1978. It provided that if your total production, now mind these words, because this is from where we are going to pick the understanding of the concept. The notification wordings are, it provided that if the total production of excisable goods in a factory does not exceed this amount, which was 13.75 lakhs in the preceding year, then clearances up to 5 lakh would be exempt. So this is very similar to the SSI exemption, which we were off late studying before the introduction of GST. Now, most important is that you are making two products. One is the exempt one, the other is a taxable one. And for the taxable product, there is another exemption which is linked to your turnover, which says that if your production of only excisable goods in the previous year exceeds this 13.75 lakhs, does not exceed 30.75 lakhs, then you will be eligible for exemption up to 5 lakhs. Now, in this relation, this particular assessee applied for this exemption or availed this exemption under the belief that he is eligible for the exemption. How? The appellant stated that in his returns, he stated that in his declaration, he stated that the turnover of his excisable goods is only 3.25 to 100. And on this basis, on the basis of this declaration, he availed the benefit of this exemption. Now, he received notice. And in the notice, the allegations were that he has made a false declaration. Now, how this declaration was false? In this particular declaration, he had considered only the turnover of Naphthol, which is a taxable product. In their language, it is an excisable product because Rapidogen was an exempted product. So he considered only the turnover of Naphthol to compute the limit of the 13.75 lakhs. And since it was below that particular limit, he bona fidely believed that his particular case was eligible for exemption on the basis of which he availed the exemption. Now, this matter was scaled up in appeal. It even went to tribunal, and even tribunal passed an order against him. Certain key pointers which were highlighted by the tribunal's decision were that a mere suppression of fact or misstatement in information statutorily required to be supplied. Now, in our case, you can say that this is GSTR 1, this is GSTR 3B to the excise authority attract larger period of limitation. So it will now fall in section 74, which has a larger period. But when it will fall? A mere suppression. Now, what was important is even the tribunal accepted the fact that only suppression of fact is sufficient to attract the higher time limit. Further, it said that intent is immaterial. So, like normally what we see in fraud cases, we look for mens rea to prove that yes, it is a fraud case. Now, here it said that the intent is immaterial insofar as there is fraud, misstatement, or suppression of facts. And further, it said that since there has been a misstatement, insofar that there has been a failure to include the quantity of the exempted supplies, hence the final conclusion by the tribunal was that you have availed the exemption wrongly, so you are liable for all tax consequences along with penalty. Now, when the matter went to the Honorable Supreme Court, the Honorable Supreme Court brought out some very important pointers, which I believe that would be very helpful when you are handling 74 notices. First is the appellate had a bona fide thought or belief that he should not include the value of the exempted supplies, that is the Rapidogen. Now, importantly, this was not merely his understanding. It was based on some rulings which were prevalent at that time. There were two high court rulings which had concluded that the goods which are exempted from duty are non-includable. Now, today, I'm sure if you see the definition under GST, it is slightly different. Under the definition of GST, if something is exempt, that would also be covered under the definition of leviable. But that is a different point. As far as the previous earlier excise regime is concerned, this was a decision. So there were two high court decisions which concluded that exempted goods should not be included in counting the turnover of excisable goods because it does not fall in the definition. Further, there was a contrary view also of another two high courts. Now, interestingly, this particular person was from Bombay, Maharashtra, and The Honorable Bombay High Court had not taken any view till this particular date. So interestingly, you had two favoring decisions, you had two contrary decisions. Now in this particular case, this particular person believed that since there were two cases, he was of the bona fide belief, he was of the bona fide impression that the Rapidogen, which is an exempted product, need not be considered as excisable goods while computing, and hence the declaration of the value of this particular product was not required in his declarations. Now in today's language, it could be GSTR 1, 3B, even 9, 9C. So what we have to understand from this particular decision and the Honorable Supreme Court's observation is that what could amount to suppression of fact. Now I'm coming to the conclusive part. The conclusive part says that in the given facts and circumstances, there is no misstatement or suppression which could be called as willful. Yes, there is a misstatement. See, there is a difference between there being a misstatement and there is a difference between the misstatement being willful. And as I was saying, the word willful is connected to both words, misstatement as well as suppression. This was the final decision of the Honorable Supreme Court in this particular case. And on this basis, we can also believe and conclude that even the language used in Section 74, which is similar to the one used in the earlier excise law, should have the same interpretation. I hope this first case study, the legacy case, would come to be of great use to you whenever you are handling 74 issues. Now, I'll just open the forum for any Q&A. You can put your queries in the Q&A session relating to this particular point, that is, what could amount to suppression of facts or misstatement. Any questions, dear members, on this? No? Great. So let us now move on to the second issue. Now, this issue is slightly off the track issue. You may not come across this particular issue very commonly, but yes, this is a very common practice, specifically whenever there are contracts and mainly when these contracts are with the government. So this particular issue, which we are going to discuss, will be impacting two aspects of the GST law. One is whether it is a supply or not. And second, it is also going to impact the valuation aspect. Now, I'm not reading out these provisions because these are the basic provisions, and I'm sure you all are well versed with the concept and definition of supply, as well as the valuation provision, specifically Section 15, Subsection 2, Clause B, which says that if some amount which the supplier was originally liable to incur in relation to that supply is eventually met by the recipient, then it should be added to the value of supply. So these two particular aspects of GST law can be very well addressed in this particular legacy case of NM Goyal and Company versus the sales tax officer. Now, let us first understand the facts of the case to appreciate what the decision is and how it is applicable to the GST law. Now, this is a very, very common thing. If you have handled any client who is a contractor, specifically a government contractor, you will find that the facts of this case will very closely, or rather I'll say it will squarely match with your case. Now, in this particular case, what happened? The appellant company was a building contractor in Madhya Pradesh, registered under the MP Sales Tax Act. Now, he applied for a tender for construction of a building for the central PWD, that is the Public Works Department, like how we also have in Maharashtra, we have the state PWD departments also. Now, in this particular contract, the most important clause, which I have not reproduced over here, it is a very big clause. It is under clause 10 of that particular contract, very clearly said that when you are applying for the tender, you have to apply for the tender, including material. So basically the contract, the tender was with material contract, but importantly further, the PWD had also mentioned in the contract itself that it would supply some of the crucial items required in this particular contract, like the iron, steel, cement, from its own stores. This was to ensure quality. This was to ensure that nothing goes wrong because the construction was of important use to the government. So it wanted to ensure quality. Hence, these important items required in the contract, even though originally part of the requirement of the supplier side, would be supplied by the PWD, who is the recipient, and whatever is the value of the quantity supplied would be adjusted against the final contract price. Now, this is a very common scenario, which at least I have seen in many of the contracts, especially the government contracts, where the contract is with material contracts. So originally the contract has put the responsibility on the supplier to meet all the expenses relating to the contract, specifically all materials. However, it may further add, or it further adds, that some of the materials, even though it is the obligation of the supplier to provide those materials or use those materials in construction, but they would be supplied by the government department to ensure quality. Now, in this particular scenario, the two aspects that we are going to handle is, one, obviously the valuation aspect, which I think we are now very clear because of 15.2b. So in this particular case study, I'm not going to highlight the valuation aspect, though I just mentioned at the start that valuation is also hit by this particular case. Now, valuation, we all are clear that, let us say the contract is of 20 CR and the value of material supplied by the PWD is, let us say, of 5 CR. So eventually, they deduct it and they only make payment of 15 CR. Still, we are all clear, I'm sure, that as per 15.2b application, the contractor, that is the supplier, is required to discharge tax on 20 CR, and there is no doubt in that. The other aspect which is highlighted in this particular case, which is a very interesting one, is what is the tax treatment of the supply made by PWD to the contractor? Interestingly, the matter which is highlighted in this particular case is not of valuation. It is of whether supplying, or now I'll use the word, whether providing provision of material by PWD to the contractor to be used in its contract, whether this provision of material by PWD to the contractor would tantamount to sale in that particular era. Now we'll use the word supply in the hands of PWD. So now here the scenario is reverse. Normally, in this particular contract, the contractor is making a supply to the PWD. However, as far as the material component is concerned, whatever material is provided by the PWD stores to the contractor to be used in this contract, the question which was brought in front of the courts was whether the supply made by the PWD to the contractor should attract tax. Now, in this regard, there were two important aspects. One, the Madhya Pradesh General Sales Tax Act, and also correspondingly the entry tax. Now, if it is proved, or if it is accepted, that the provision of material by the PWD stores to the contractor is a sale in the hands of PWD, then both these taxes would be attracted. And like how we have the concept of RCM, similar concept was there, that at that time, the contractor was required to pay the purchase tax instead of sales tax. It was purchase tax because it was similar to our concept of RCM. Now, in this particular relation, the observations of the court are very interesting. Now, before I go to what the courts have concluded, what is your view? You can just put it in the chat box also. Whether do you feel it is a sale? You can say yes or no. I'm talking sales in the hands of the PWD, as far as the material is provided by PWD to the contractor. What do you feel? Whether do you feel that this will be sale in the hands of PWD? Yes or no? If you feel it is a sale in the hands of PWD, you can say yes. If you feel no, it is just part of the contract that PWD is providing the material to be used by the contractor, you can say no. Yes. Anybody would like to add your views? Manish is saying no. Great. Anil Kumar ji is also saying no. Rajesh ji says yes. Okay. Two participants have raised hands. Sir, I feel, means I don't know whether you can unmute or not, but if allowed, you can even unmute and put your views.
Sir, all participants are requested to post in Q&A box.
Perfect. And that is best. You can put it in the, since this is only question answer, you can put it in the chat box, and your queries you can put in the Q&A.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. So those who have raised hands, I'll request that you may just put your answers in the chat box. And if you have any queries, you can put it in the Q&A box. Okay, so I've received majorly the answer is no. Okay, great. Now let's see what the Honorable Supreme Court feels. What it says, Madhya Pradesh sales tax and assessment of entry tax under this section, the entry of material could be presumed to have been made at the instance of the appellant, who is the contractor, who had ultimately used the material for the construction work. And since these materials were purchased, now this word is important, since these were purchased from the unregistered dealer, that is a PWD, the applicant was liable for payment of purchase tax and entry tax. Hence, the final conclusion was, the question therefore was whether there was a sale of iron, steel and cement by PWD while supplying those materials to the contractor to be used in the construction. The answer was, by use or consumption of material in the construction work, there was a passing of property. Now, I'm sure you all would appreciate this point that sales tax law required the passing of title. Only then it could tantamount to sale. Now, here, if we look at from the perspective of supply, in fact, this is even a bigger concept, supply. Sale is one small component. There is transfer, there is sale, there is exchange, there is even disposing of, that is also supply. So if in the sales tax regime, this was concluded to be a supply, stating that one, that there was a passing of property by the PWD to the contractor, also by appropriation and by agreement, there was a sale as envisaged in the clause 10. Hence, the final conclusion was that the full bench was right, means the Supreme Court was accepting the decision of the High Court, that there was a sale which was liable to tax. Now, if you ask me, okay, what is my personal view? Frankly speaking, when I was reading the case for the first time 2 years back, my personal view when I started reading the facts of the case was that this is not a sale. Yes, if I'm looking it from the GST perspective, yes, I had a dicey view that it could be a supply, because as I said, that the definition of supply is very wide. But by the time I reached to the conclusion of that particular case, I myself had a great revelation that, okay, this could also be sale. But still, very frankly, till date, despite of handling this particular matter on different forums, discussing on different forums, to my mind, I have not yet been able to understand how there could be passing of property. But yes, the Honorable Supreme Court has also accepted the decision of the High Court, stating that yes, there was a passing of property, so that was a sale. And if that is a sale, automatically there is no question or doubt that whether it would be supply or not, it would definitely be a supply even under GST. So when I started studying the case, my perspective was mainly on the valuation side. So yes, I concluded at the start only as far as valuation is concerned, no challenge. Contractor has to pay tax on the entire value. But when the question arose that whether it would be sale in the hands of PWD, my answer was no. But by the end of this entire case, when I read the entire conclusion, I don't know why, it was still not acceptable to me. But fine, if you go by this particular decision, if a similar fact is there with you in any of your case, please inform the respective government authority that yes, they are also covered under the definition of supply as far as whatever material they have supplied to the contractor. Now, the question over here is that we are talking about this particular case and the decision is very much specific to the facts of the case. Now, interestingly, when we discuss on various forums, a question comes to us that can we have a different terms of contract and can changing the terms of the contract have an impact on the decision that whether it is a sale or supply or not? To my understanding, definitely a big yes. By redrafting the contract, redrafting the clauses, you can definitely put a clause which clearly states that this particular property would remain of the PWD and they would always have a control over the goods. Only they are used or they are provided to be used. And if you have such an express clause, I believe, this is my understanding, that this could be outside the GST net, that there should not be a taxability in the hands of PWD. This is what I believe. Yes, this is a very open case and it will always be very much dependent on the actual facts and the circumstances. There is a point in Q&A which says that, but there was a sale consideration received by PWD. Still, it is a sale. Achha, you are saying there was no sale consideration. Anil Kumarji, I believe that there was a sale consideration. If you're talking about consideration, there was a sale consideration because to the extent of the value of material supplied by PWD to the contractor, there was an adjustment made in the contract price. To that extent, PWD was supposed to pay less. So obviously there was a consideration. It was not a supply of material without consideration. So there is no question of whether there was a consideration or not, because to that extent, the value, the contract price was adjusted. So this is how this particular case is. I'm sure this would be also a revelation for most of you. as it was for me. So I thought of taking this in our discussion, though it is a very specific case, may not be applicable in general. But yes, if you have a similar scenario, you can always refer to this particular decision. Now, coming to a very important burning issue, which I'm sure you all would be handling in your offices relating to input tax rate. And for this, we have a very great judgment in our favor of Arise India. This is what we are going to discuss in detail. I'm sure many of you would have read or heard about Arise India, but many times we go through the WhatsApp, which is always a very small two-liner or a small one-pager type of thing. Here we are going to go in detail of this particular concept. The reason being why I've selected this case, because this may be very much known to y'all, but the reason is that tomorrow when you are answering notices, which definitely you would be receiving relating to mismatch of 2A2B or non-payment of tax by the supplier, if we understand the facts of this particular case in great detail, I'm sure it would help you a lot in your litigation relating to this particular matter. So the relevance of this is in relation to Section 16 condition, which requires specifically that you can avail ITC only when the supplier has paid a tax. And also now they are also taking the 2A2B mismatch issues. So definitely you can use this particular case. Now, actually, though we are referring to the decision of Arise India Limited, but if you see the case, many similar writs were merged and all writs were heard together, but still we always refer to Arise India case. The reason is, even though the decision was common, but all other writs and Arise India were distinguished in a sense that in case of Arise India, there was a very favorable decision specific to Arise India, and for remaining writs, the matter was reverted back to be reviewed because there was some difference in facts of the cases. Hence, we always refer to Arise India case only and not the remaining cases, though they were clubbed together with this particular writ. Now, what are the facts of the case? In the facts, the name is taken off some other writ because that is how the order has come out, but the facts are similar to all of us. So the facts are of Suhasini Charitable Trust, which is a registered entity under the Delhi VAT, and it is engaged in the activity of providing food items in Akshardham Temple. Now, for providing these food items, it is making a lot of purchases on which it is paying the Delhi VAT, and it has availed the ITC of the VAT which it has paid to its suppliers. Now, most important, it has made purchasing from those dealers who are also registered under the Delhi VAT, and on the strength of the invoices which prove the collection of tax by the vendor from the purchasing dealer and is a valid document of availing ITC. So all facts, if you see, are very similar to the facts which you have in your office, that your particular client is having valid tax invoice. The tax invoice shows that the vendor has collected tax from you. The payment details shows that the vendor has collected tax from you. But the only problem is the vendor has not deposited the tax with the government. Here in this particular case, it was also a genuine reason that there was a fire and there was destruction of records, and the vendor, Messrs. Vidya Polymers, failed to deposit the VAT which it collected from its buyer, that is the Suhasini Charitable Trust. So this is a very straightforward case which we all are handling in our offices. Now, before we go to the decision, I have tried to analyze this particular case in lot detail so that we can understand all the aspects, so that tomorrow if you have to argue with the officer, the facts of these cases and all these submissions and counter submissions can be helpful. So the first part, the submission from the side of the dealer was that Section 9.2G of the Delhi VAT Act, which is similar to our Section 16.2C, is to be struck down. What was the reason given by the petitioner? That it treats both the guilty purchaser and the innocent purchaser at par. And this is what is wrong. And again, it is also challenging Article 14. So it further states, the submission states that guilty purchasers are the one who are in collusion with the guilty seller and they have intention to evade tax. Now, it is not as if the government is not having the machinery. So second contention was that if there are guilty purchaser, guilty sellers, then even if they are resorting to malpractices of evading tax, but the government has all the machinery, it has all the law backing to take action. And it is very vivid in Section 40A of the Delhi VAT Act, which was specifically enacted to give power to the Delhi government and the power to the department to collect tax from such guilty purchasers and sellers. The next point is Section 9.2G was considered or claimed to be arbitrary, irrational, unduly harsh, and hence violative of Article 14. Further, most important, the word used is dealer, like how in our GST law the word used is registered person. Here also, a very interesting submission was that the entire law uses the word dealer, dealer, dealer. Here it uses the word registered person, registered person. So now the another submission by the petitioner was that when we are reading the word dealer occurring in this particular section, it should be read down to exclude those dealers who are honest. Means this particular submission states that the petitioner requested that when you're reading that, okay, the dealer should be denied an input tax credit, like how here it is said that the registered person should be denied input tax credit. The term registered person for the purpose of this section, limited only for the purpose of this section, should be read in a limited sense to only address the guilty purchasers and not all the purchasers. Here it has said that it should be read down to exclude the honest purchasers and to include only the guilty purchasers who have collaborated with the sellers and they have collectively resorted to some malpractices. Now, these were the submissions made by the petitioner for which there was counter argument by the department side. First, it said that merely arbitrariness cannot be a ground for challenging the statute as far as Article 14 is concerned. So what was one of the contentions? What, that it is arbitrary? This cannot be the ground to challenge it on the basis of Article 14. Further, interestingly, what it further said, that mere hardship caused by the impossibility of compliance cannot be ground for striking down a statute. Now, we are in all our submission using this legal maxim of that if something is impossible, which cannot be done in normal course of trade, then that particular section, that particular law becomes inoperative, or it is what we say, not valid. Now, this particular point was also challenged, saying that mere hardship in doing something impossible cannot be the ground for striking down the law. Fine. And then most important, which is also very, very relevant to all of us, is that whenever we try to argue these cases, the officer always comes up with this submission that, boss, your own Maharashtra High Court, that is the Bombay High Court, in a very famous decision of Mahalakshmi Cotton Mills, has clearly disallowed the ITC to the buyers. So you are covered by your High Court and hence you are also required to reverse. Now, this is very interesting how this has been finally answered. This is very interesting for us and that is why I took all the detailed submissions. Now, coming to the observations by the court. Now, the court had to counter all these arguments of the department. So one by one, it said, to be eligible for ITC, what does the VAT law requires that you should be registered? Now, see, try to match it with your section 16 conditions of GST, it is copy paste. So to be eligible, you require to be registered, fine. And you have to take care to verify that the dealer is also registered, fine. We get to know from the portal and we can verify we have the GST number. The second condition is that such dealer has to issue a proper tax invoice. This is also a condition over here. Section 16.2A has the first condition that you should have a proper valid tax invoice. And also, such invoice would obviously set out the TIN number of the selling. So all these conditions are similar to what we have in our GST law also. Next, as long as the purchasing dealer has taken all steps, now this is the most important part, he cannot be expected to keep a track of whether the selling dealer is actually depositing the tax with the government. Further, the purchasing dealer can of course ascertain if there is any mismatch. Now, interestingly, over there also in Delhi VAT, they had 2A, 2B. Like how we here have J1, J2 in our VAT laws, they had 2A, 2B. But here we have 2A, 2B, both are from the purchasing side. Over there, 2A, 2B, one is from purchasing, one is from the selling side. So the purchasing dealer can of course ascertain if there is any mismatch of 2A and 2B, like how we have J1, J2. Assuming it is on account of the seller's refer, there is little he can do about it. This is also very important that even if you identify that there is mismatch, what action you can take as a buyer. Now, most interestingly, we'll find this in the next part of this presentation also, that another difficulty is that the purchasing dealer foes is that he has no access to the return filed by the selling dealer. Now, this is where the legal maxim that you cannot be made to do what is impossible holds good in this particular case. That even though the law says that, okay, you can take credit only if the supplier has paid tax. Now, how will you ensure whether or not the supplier has paid tax? First, secondly, most important, If you read the section 16.2c, it says that the supplier should have paid tax either in cash or by utilizing ITC, and the word used is admissible ITC. Now you tell me one thing. Now this is very important, because nowadays we are also facing the issue of circular trading, where suddenly you get a letter, or you get rather summons nowadays. And when you attend the summons, you are informed that your supplier was involved in circular trading, and he had taken some invoices which were part of circular trading, which gave him ITC, which obviously, since it is part of circular trading, is not a valid ITC. And since he has utilized that ITC to discharge your tax, hence we will disallow you credit also. Now just understand one point, dear members. If he has availed ITC, which because of any reason, circular trading, fake invoicing, whatever could be the reason, is not correct, or maybe he has taken some ITC which is not eligible because it is covered in section 17.5, how are you as a purchasing dealer, by any means, by any 2A, 2B, by any means, how you as a purchasing dealer will get to know whether what ITC he has taken and utilized for discharging your tax was admissible? This is the most important point which we can highlight when we are replying to these notices, because section 16.2c says that he should have paid tax either by utilizing cash ledger, fine, or by utilizing his admissible ITC. Now this part, that he has utilized admissible ITC, is impossible for me to check. I cannot go and check his records. He will not allow me the access. Then how can I be penalized if he has not paid tax, or if he has not utilized the ITC correctly? This is a very important stand. Further, what were the observations? Again, it is not as if the department is helpless. If the selling dealer commits a default in either depositing or lawfully adjusting the VAT collected, there is provision under the Delhi VAT Act which empowers the department to proceed against the selling dealer. Similar provisions we also have in our GST law. That where, now let me tell you, the recent Finance Act 2021 has made an amendment in section 74, whereby a similar point has been included, that where supplier has reported some sale in GSTR 1, but he has not paid tax in GSTR 3, this would be considered as his assessed tax liability, and action can be taken under 74. It means there is all the provisions in the law which gives the power to the officer to take action against the supplier. So first thing, we are not aware whether he has correctly utilized his ITC or not, or whether firstly his ITC was admissible or not. So we have no control to ensure whether he has correctly paid tax or not. Second, officer has all the control. He has all the machinery to check whether or not the supplier has paid tax, whether he has availed the ITC correctly or not. Now, these two important grounds. And then the third point, the failure to distinguish bona fide purchasing dealer from those that are not results in 9.2G applying equally to both class of purchasing dealer, and hence it attracts invalidation under Article 14 of the Constitution. So this particular point, this observation of the court, also nullifies the submission by the department that 14 cannot be used over here, because this particular article of the Constitution required that you should be treated in a correct manner. There should be equality in treatment. In this particular article is not being satisfied, because you are treated unfairly, because you are treated at par with those dealers who are actually dishonest, who are collaborating with the sellers and getting into some fake invoicing or such type of things. Yes, you can deny them, but you cannot deny the same thing to a purchasing dealer who is a bona fide and honest dealer. Now, on these grounds, it further said that there was need to restrict denial of ITC. Correct. But only to the selling dealer who has failed to deposit the tax collected by them and not punish the bona fide purchasing dealer. And also, it can straight away be seen that Section 48.5, now this is very important for us, of the MVAT Act, that is Maharashtra VAT Act, is not an exact replica of 9.2G. Now, this is where the Honorable Court is trying to now compare this with the Mahalakshmi Cotton case and trying to distinguish the Delhi VAT with that, saying that you are referring to Mahalakshmi Cotton case, but it is not applicable to Delhi VAT. And I'll tell you, it is also not applicable to GST, because GST and Delhi VAT provisions are similar. So we can always take this ground that Mahalakshmi Cotton Mill case is not equally applicable to us. Why? Because the court finds that there is no provision in the Maharashtra VAT Act similar to Section 48 of Delhi VAT Act. And Section 48 of Delhi VAT Act takes care of the situation where selling dealer and purchasing dealer act in collision. So important. That is why even the contention taken by the officer that, okay, Mahalakshmi Cotton Mills is against you, so we are applying that case, can be challenged by you on this grounds. So finally, even in Mahalakshmi Cotton, even though it is against the dealer, there is interesting observation even in that. The operative directions in the Mahalakshmi Cotton Pressing Mills case indicates that such a measure was suggested by the state government itself to go after the defaulters in the selling dealer failing to actually pay. So even despite of the Mahalakshmi Cotton Mill case being against the dealers, still in that particular case itself, there was a submission by the government that they will first go after the defaulting selling dealers and not directly make the buyer reverse the ITC. This was a submission. Hence, the department there undertook to upload on its website the details of defaulting sellers. It was further undertaken that once there was a final recovery of tax from selling dealers, refund would be granted to purchasing dealers. So this is a very important aspect of the Mahalakshmi Cotton Mill case. We only say that, okay, it is against the dealer, but this was also an important part of the case that over there, the government itself gave a submission that, yes, we will first take action against the selling dealer. And in case we recover tax from them, then whatever ITC we have asked the buying dealer to reverse, we will refund it to them. Now, coming to the conclusion, which is very important for us. In the light of the above legal position, the court held that dealer or class of dealers, the word used in section 9.2G, which is similar to 16.2C, should be interpreted as not including the dealers who have bona fide entered into purchase transaction with valid registered selling dealer. So where the purchasing dealer is honest, you should not take action against them. Applying section 16.2C, this is what is the final outcome. That is, they are reading down that particular section to exclude from that section the honest dealers and only to cover dishonest dealers. And finally, in the event that the selling dealer has failed to deposit the tax collected by him from buying dealer, the remedy for the department would be to proceed against the defaulting selling dealer first to recover such tax and simply not deny the purchasing dealer the ITC. So this is also very categorically stated. Here I will add one more case law of the Honorable Madras High Court, the Madurai bench. That is in the DY Bethel industry case. You can also use that. Over there also, a similar decision was taken that until and unless it is proved that there is a collusion between the buyer and the seller, you should not deny ITC to the buyer, even though the seller has not deposited tax first. Second, a very important part over there, which I would give as a small suggestion, that whenever you are handling such a case, you should always ask your officer to give you a facility of cross-examining the seller. This was same thing which happened in the DY Bethel case, where the purchasing dealer, when he was put upon the charge to reverse his input tax credit under VAT, he asked for cross-examining the seller, which was denied to him. And this happens in most of the cases, that if you ask your officer to give you the facility to cross-examine the seller, many a times it is possible that he will not allow you the facility and still he will pass order against you. If you ask for this facility and if it is denied to you, you will be having an upper hand when you go in for appeals, because that was one of the aspects of natural justice. You had all the rights to confront the selling dealer and ask him why he did not pay the tax despite of collecting it from you. And if the officer does not allow you this facility of cross-examination, you are at a very big plus point when you go in for appeals. So you should also do this whenever you are handling this particular matter. And you should also remember the other case, that is of DY Bethel, passed by the Honorable Madras High Court, the Madurai bench. So this is all about this particular case. I'm sure this is going to be of great help to you whenever you are handling this particular matter of ITC reversal or 2A, 2B mismatches. Now, similarly, since we are on the ITC point, let me also add to you this particular aspect, few more legacy decisions about this question, because this is always a heated debate that whether ITC is a legal right, whether it is a constitutional right, or it is only a benefit or concession. Now, let me first give you the answer to this so that when we discuss the cases, it would be of great value addition. If we go to the legacy cases, all the legacy cases majorly highlight this common point. You'll find a common thread flowing through all the cases, whether it be of the central excise or of respective state VATs, that input tax credit or SenVAT credit or VAT credit, whatever is the name, is originally a benefit or concession first. But once you satisfy the underlying conditions given in the law, then it takes the color of a constitutional right or a privilege. Means what? Per se, the input tax credit under GST is not your constitutional right, but the moment you satisfy the conditions of Section 16, now when I'm saying conditions of Section 16, you have to keep Section 16 2C aside or read Section 16 2C only in light of the Arise India and the DY Bethel case, that so far as you are a genuine purchasing dealer, even though supplier has not paid tax, still it would be treated as compliance of 16 2C. So once you comply with the conditions of Section 16 2C, then it would become your constitutional right. So how do we get this particular conclusion? Let us go to the legacy cases giving this. The most revered decision is of the Eicher Motors, where under the earlier excise, you are allowed to take credit when the goods enter the factory. However, it said that, yes, you are allowed to take credit immediately, but only on the basis of existing scheme. So once you satisfy all the requirements of the existing scheme, that is of the excise scheme, then in this particular case, you will be allowed credit. And most importantly, once you satisfy all the requirements of the scheme, once the credit is availed as per the scheme, then it becomes your indefeasible right. That is, then it will become your constitutional right. So most important, and this is the most revered decision you can always use of Eicher Motors, that once you satisfy the conditions, then it becomes an indefeasible right. Now, how you can apply this in the GST law? It can be applied in many cases. Like first, if we all would have observed that in case of textile sector earlier, refund of inverted duty structure was not allowed. Then from August 2018, they started allowing this refund, but there was a notification 20/2018, which said that, okay, we are going to allow it from August onwards, but whatever was your accumulated ITC up to 31st July, you will have to lapse it. Now this was challenged, and there is a favoring decision by the Gujarat, Honorable Gujarat High Court in case of Sabnam Petrofills, but still the matter is pending with the Honorable Supreme Court. But most important, the point is that here Eicher Motors decision can be applied, and this can be applied in all those cases where you have satisfied the conditions for availing ITC. And once you have availed it, then it cannot be denied. It cannot be asked to be reversed or lapsed. That is the most important point. So you can apply this decision first over here. Second, nowadays we all are facing challenge of 86A blocking. Now that itself is a whole separate topic of discussion, but when you are handling those matters and where you feel that the action taken by the officer is unjustified and incorrect, you can use Eicher Motors over there, that you had taken ITC in the first place correctly and you have satisfied all the conditions given in Section 16. And since also 86A, Rule 86A has no legal backing, that is why the officer has no rights to block your credit. You can always use this stance. Also, this would have happened more in the initial years of GST, for which now you may be handling issues of GST audit in the audit by the department or in the notices that you're handling. The issue is that the supplier charged the correct tax. Sorry, I'm having some disturbance. Achha, Jatin bhai is there. Okay, great. Fine. I'll just complete this point. It has happened that in some of the cases, the supplier has charged correct tax. Let us say he charged IGST in his invoice, but when you were availing the credit, by mistake, it was entered in the CGST, SGST column of 3B. Now, the question is that you have availed the credit. The credit is availed. You have satisfied all conditions of Section 16. The only problem is it went to the wrong bucket. Now, today, when the GST audit is happening, they are coming out with the issue that you have wrongly availed the credit. Now you have to reverse the credit. Fine, that is okay. But they are saying that you can also not avail the right credit because the time has lapsed under Section 16.4. Now in this particular case, you can always use this decision whereby you can contend that, hey boss, I have satisfied all the conditions of Section 16 and only the bucket was wrong. Instead of putting it in IGST, I had put it in CNS. This is not going to defy my rights, and I'm very legitimately eligible for this particular ITC. Jatin bhai is there. Sir, would you like to add something on this?
Vishal, I think you should continue. Maybe at 6:45, I'll try it. I have heard you most of the time.
Okay.
So I'll conclude at 6:45.
Please, sir, please. So I'll complete my presentation and I'll hand it over to you, sir. Okay. Also, the challenge of whether 16.4 time limit is valid or not, you can always use this particular case. Over there, The first stance is 16-2. Override 16-4 because 16-2 starts with a non-obstanted clause. And that is why 16-4 is subservient to 16-2. And you can always use Eicher Motor case that since you have satisfied all the conditions of 16-1 and 16-2, hence it becomes your indefeasible right. And simply a time limit condition under 16-4 cannot deny you this particular right. Next important decision is of Godrej and Boyce Manufacturing Company. Over there also, similar per matter was put that whether this particular input tax credit can be your right or benefit. It is again saying that where you are satisfying all the conditions, it becomes a right. But until and unless you have satisfied the conditions, it only remains as a concession. Most important case, Daiichi Kakaria. You can always use this in many cases. Again, what it highlights, there are two, three things which are highlighted in this case. First is, once you make requisite declaration and you obtain acknowledgement, here declaration is similar to what we file returns over here. Once you have made requisite declaration, then it becomes your right and you can always avail it and utilize it despite of any future changes in the law, like what we saw notification asking you to reverse or lapse the credit, that will not affect your right. Also, another point emphasized in Daiichi Kakaria is that one-to-one correlation is not required. Anyways, there is no such challenge in the GST law also. Next important, JM Company's case. Question is, whenever there is a concession given, the most important is it is coming with some conditions attached to it. And you have to strictly comply with these conditions. Only then you would be legitimately eligible. So again, it also follows the same thread. And interestingly, another decision in the Karnataka value added tax of this MK Agrotech, where it says that how much taxes credit is to be allowed under what circumstances is purely the domain of the legislature. And it has all the rights to put conditions and you have to comply with the condition, only then you will be legitimately eligible for this. So all these cases ultimately highlight the same point that yes, it is a concession, it is a benefit, but the moment you comply with all the requirements of the law, it would take the color of an indefeasible right. Now, some more legacy decisions relating to particular points. Now, we just discussed section 16.4. In my previous slide, I was saying that section 16.4 is subservient to section 16.2. And going through all these legacy cases, the requirement is the moment you satisfy all the conditions, you are legitimately eligible to claim and utilize the credit. Now, here the challenge in GST law is section 16.2 gives the condition, which is a non-obstanted clause. It says that notwithstanding anything contained in entire section 16. So it means 16.2 even overrides 16.4. Now, 16.4 puts a time limit to avail credit. Now, the question is, now we all are facing this. You may not have availed time limit. You may not have availed the ITC within the time limit. Question is, can you be required to reverse the credit? Now, here we have a decision against us. So I have tried to highlight this in ALD Automotive Limited. It is said that input tax is in the nature of benefit concession extended to the dealer under the statutory scheme, and the concession can be received by the beneficiary only as per the scheme. Now here, in this particular case, the credit was denied on the basis of time limit criteria. Now many times, this case is used against us by the officer, or in appeal stages, this may be used by the opposite person. But let me tell you, this case will not apply to the GST law for the simple reason that under the Tamil Nadu VAT law, the condition of time limit was part of the main section giving the timelines or giving the conditions. However, the difference between the Tamil Nadu VAT law and the GST law is under GST law, section 16.2 gives the conditions. It is a notwithstanding section, so it overrides all other sections. And then the time limit is given under 16.4. So this is where you can distinguish both these sections. And that is why this contrary decision, which says that you can avail ITC only if it is done within timeline, will not apply to us under the GST law. Next. Another issue is that the law requires that you will be allowed ITC only when you have used or you intend to use the input service capital goods in the course or furtherance of business. Now, interestingly, what is the meaning of in furtherance of business? Now, this particular phrase is yet to be explored under GST. Yes, we can say in the course of business means something which is directly, indirectly part of your business. That is in the course of business. But what would be in furtherance of business? Now, in this regard, we have an interesting case law of Coca-Cola India Limited. Now, let us first understand the basic facts of the case so that you'll appreciate the decision and how it can be used in our GST. We all know that Coca-Cola, Pepsi, all these are into the business of selling aerated drinks, what we call as cold drinks. Now, importantly, these companies, if you see their sales side, they sell concentrates. The concentrates are sold to the bottling units, and the bottling units are the one who are responsible for making the cold drinks and selling in the market. So Coca-Cola company, Pepsi company is selling the concentrates and not the cold drinks. Now, in this particular case, the challenge was that these companies spend huge amount on advertisements, huge amount on endorsement, and also spend a huge amount on sponsorship. So their P&L debit side is loaded with huge expenses on all these things, advertisement, endorsement, and also sponsorship. Interestingly, all advertisements are of the cold drinks. Not a single advertisement is of the concentrate. Now, the challenge over here, which was raised, was that you will be denied input tax credit of whatever taxes, service tax you have paid on the advertisements, because what you are selling is concentrate, whereas what is getting advertised is the cold drinks. So you have paid for the advertisement of cold drinks, but your sale, your supply is of the concentrates. Interesting point to be noted over here is, if we compare the definition of input, input service and capital goods of the CENVAT scheme with our GST law, there is a big difference. The CENVAT scheme definitions, if you have read or if you remember, are very, very strict. So what could be treated as inputs, input services or capital goods has been very precisely defined. And most importantly, when you see the definition of input service, it has come with lot many strict conditions. Whereas if you compare it with the definition under the GST scheme, the GST definitions are very wide as far as input, input service and capital goods are concerned. It simply says it should be in the course or furtherance of business. Whereas here, in most of the cases, a direct connection with manufacturer, direct connection with output service was required. Now, please appreciate this point. This particular decision is pertaining to the CENVAT scheme, where the conditions were strict. You are required to establish a connection, and that condition is not there in GST law. So to that extent, GST law is already liberal. Still, this particular decision, despite being of the CENVAT era, which was having strict conditions, still it says that because the advertisement, even though it is of the cold drink, would ultimately impact or help in promoting the sales of the concentrate, because more the cold drinks are sold, ultimately that will increase the sales of concentrate. Hence, even though there is no direct connection between the advertisement, which is of cold drink, and your supply, which is of concentrate, still the input tax credit would be allowed. Now, this I think can be used as a precedence to understand what could be the meaning of the phrase furtherance of business, because this is a new phrase used in the GST law. So we can say that in the course of business means something which is directly connected, directly identifiable, whereas in furtherance of business would mean something which may not be identifiable today, but yes, it has an impact, whereby by spending that amount, by making those purchases, it could help you in achieving sales, maybe in immediate or in distant future. So this is how we can understand the meaning of furtherance of business. Now, this logic of furtherance of business can also be applied in the CSR expenses issue, which I'm sure that the CSR expense issue is another burning issue right now. One second before I start this, Jatin bhai, if you are there, I think I'll be completing my slide in next 10 minutes. Organizers, if you can just ping Jatin sir, if by chance he is not there, that I may be completing in next 10 minutes.
I'll ping him.
Yeah. Now, CSR expenses is again today a lot of litigated issue, that whether you will be allowed credit of CSR expenses or not. Now, before I come to the specific decisions which we have in favor of CSR expenses, but I would like to first again address the same point of furtherance of business. I personally believe that CSR expenses should be allowed under GST, despite of first that they are disallowed under income tax law, but that is a specific disallowance. Please understand, it is not disallowed automatically. They have to include it specifically in the law stating that it is disallowed. It means if that specific disallowance would not have been given, it could be allowed, or it would be allowed even under the income tax law, but the law did not want to allow, so they have disallowed one. But if some law is disallowing, that will not lead to automatic disallowance in the other law. First thing. Second important thing about CSR is that CSR expenses are mandatory. So I cannot block it under 17.5H, which is the general contention, because 17.5H blocks something which is in the nature of gift. CSR cannot be termed as gift because it is mandatory in nature. Second point. Third point, CSR is in the furtherance of business. One, if I don't spend this amount, which is a compulsion by the company law, it will have a negative impact on my business as far as the company law application is concerned. Secondly, by spending this amount, it is somewhere augmenting the image of my company, image of my business. So it is going to have a future benefit. So this is how also CSR will easily fit in the concept of in the furtherance of business. Now we go to some very specific decisions, which are again of the pre-GST era. And they are again of the CENVAT and the central excise era, where I will again like to highlight the point that central excise CENVAT scheme had a very strict definition for input service. It required a linking with manufacturer. It required a linking with provision of output service. And despite of such strict definition, if it is allowed in the pre-GST era, that is under the central excise law, why it can be blocked under the GST law? Whereas the provisions under GST law are much liberal. And yes, 17.5H, which is blocking over here, a similar blocking was there even under the CENVAT scheme. So if you have these decisions, which are given under the earlier scheme, which was much stricter in terms of the definition, then I don't think there is any reason why we should be disallowed the ITC of CSR expenses. So there are two important decisions. One is of Sterlite Industries and the other one is of SL Propack. In Sterlite Industries, it was said that if we compare GST with pre-GST taxes, we observe that GST has much wider ITC. If CENVAT was allowed on CSR before GST, the same should be allowed. Next, what does SL Propack say? CSR is not in the nature of charity. It augments the credit rating of the company and it has also been made obligatory. So it cannot fit in 17.5H and hence it should be allowed. So these are the case laws, case studies, which I could prepare in the time available with me. I'm sure this would have added value to you. Now, if Jatin sir is available, I would request Jatin bhai to please take over the charge so that we all will be able to hear his views on all the points and he can add more case studies. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Vishal. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
You're audible.
Thank you. First of all, thank you, Vishal, for preparing the PPT and giving presentation at this, I would say, very short span of time. And I'm sure all the participants must have enjoyed it. And my apology to all the participants and the organizers that due to some circumstances, I was not in a situation to speak. But as of now, I am a bit comfortable. So let me go through with it. I heard Vishal partly in the initial time, not but whole of the session. Anyways, so before I start maybe coming on the topics, what has been taken by the Vishal, I believe when we are having a topic like legacy judgments, first of all, we need to understand whether all of these judgments are applicable or will be made applicable in the GST regime or not. And how the law of precedence gets governed in our country. So let me first start with the constitutional provision, which is Article 141. See, Article 141 says that law declared by the Supreme Court, it talks only and only about Supreme Court, shall be binding on all courts in the territory of the India. This is what section, this is what Article 141 of the Constitution of India, which talks about Supreme Court. So we can say whatever has been declared and decided by the Supreme Court is nothing less than the law of the land. It is a constitutional provision. Moving ahead, we are having one celebrated judgment from Supreme Court in the name of Kamakshi Finance Corporation Limited. That was a very interesting judgment. And in fact, even on today's era, we use it. We use it regularly. Let me tell you how. And rather, I would like whatever kind of judgment I'm discussing it with you, I will try to correlate it with the present scenario. Only a couple of months ago, what happened? I have received a case where what happened? The orders under the VAT Act was passed by the authority and some demand was created on a particular legal point in three consecutive assessment years, 14, 15, 15, 16, and 16, 17. Now what happened? Assessee filed the appeal against all the three orders before the first appellate authority. First appellate authority remanded the case to the assessing authority with a specific observation which were in favor of the assessee. That means they have cleared legal position and for the purposes of quantification, they have referred it back to the assessing officer. Now what happened? Out of these three cases, department went into appeal in two cases, 15, 16 and 16, 17. Department missed filing of the appeal in case of 14, 15, though legal position or points were same. Now what happened? The cases are still pending before the tribunal or the second appellate authority of the two cases. Meanwhile, the assessing authority realized that we did a mistake, that we have not filed appeal in the case of 14, 15. So now he has passed a fresh order, citing some different cases, some different logics. That, okay, in light of these facts, the case is again decided the way the assessing authority earlier decided. The way assessing authority earlier decided, that means more or less copy paste of the original order. Meaning thereby, he disobeyed the judgment of the first appellate authority. Now, if I directly link it up with the Article 141, it doesn't get links. So this is what I have shared the situation with you, the case which I received a couple of months ago. Exactly in a similar manner, what happened in case of Kamlakshi Finance Corporation Limited, this was again an excise case. Similar situations happened and the authorities went against the order of their higher authorities. Honorable Madras High Court came heavily on that. Rather, they have imposed the cost that how come you can disobey the judgment of your senior authority. By this way, there will be no rule of law and order in the country if everybody starts doing so. And when the petition was filed before Honorable Supreme Court. Supreme Court, with the same intensity, confirmed the judgment of the Honorable High Court. Rather, there was a specific request from the government side, from the government leader side, that to remove the cost at least. And that was also not being agreed by the Supreme Court. They have specifically wrote, we understand that whatever is done by the officer is in the interest of the revenue. Even then, we cannot allow ki aap apne superior authorities ke orders ko, judicial orders ko, maybe including quasi-judicial order ko, you'll not obey that. He said, we will not allow this. So, if you read it, Article 141, in light of this Supreme Court judgment, then we understand how law of precedence works in our country. Moving ahead. When we talk about that GST is a new regime implemented or started with effect from 1st July 2017. Now you all will agree with me how department reacts. Whenever you are going to cite a particular judgment, maybe Vishal must have discussed with you 6, 7, 8 judgments which are favorable to the assessee. Whenever you are going to quote those judgments into the maybe before the assessing authority or I'm sure before the first appellate authority. In those cases, what department will do? No. This is not of our state. This judgment is of maybe facts are different. Maybe these things are different or maybe this is not applicable to us. So in my humble opinion, and now what happened? And even if something favorable advance ruling is being given by the different state authority, they will follow that. It's favorable to the revenue, if it is favorable to the revenue. So they are not using the same yardstick for the SSE and for the departmental cases. That's the biggest issue. So what is the decision? What kind of decisions are binding on any person? Please refer one of the celebrated judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court in case of Ramesh Food Products, 2004-174-80. See, in that case, first of all, Supreme Court has specifically said that summary dismissal cannot be treated as precedent. Let us take an example. You must have discussed Arise India in this session. Now, what happened? The SLP filed against Arise India was dismissed. But whether it was dismissed in a summary manner or whole of the case has been discussed at length and then on merits, it was rejected. This is important to understand whether it is a quotability of the Supreme Court will come or not. If you refer this, then Arise India was dismissed by the Supreme Court in a summary manner. They have not entered in the merits. So still we will have to say this is the judgment of the Delhi High Court only. To the extent of, for that particular SSE, Arise India or maybe for the person who were there in the petition, we can say now the case are over for them, but as a precedential value, it will be treated as a judgment of the Delhi Court. See, in MCD versus Gurnam Kaur, Supreme Court has specifically clarified that quotability of the law applies to the principle of the case only. Only and only on the principle of the case, that is its ratio decidendi, not to the obiter. So obiter has like a only persuasive value. It has a only and only persuasive value. A case is the authority only for what is actually decides, what it actually decides, and not for what may logically can flow from it. I hope you are following me. The binding nature of the decision is only and only for the principles which has been decided, and that is there in the only ratio decidendi. That means the conclusion of the case in light of the fact, legal position in light of
let him rejoin.
Seems there is some issue. Sorry, members.
He will rejoin it.
Yeah, no problems.
He's rejoining in a while. One minute.
Yeah, yeah, sir. No problem. Let us see. Members, we have a temporary disruption. Maybe we, Jatin sir has lost the connection due to some technicalities. He's rejoining in 2 minutes. Sorry for the inconvenience. Yes, sir. You can continue, sir.
Maybe there is it audible now?
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Sorry, it got disconnected.
No, no problem at all, sir. You can continue. Okay.
So I think I was discussing MCD versus Gurnam Kaur. So quotability applies only and only to the ratios, and that too in light of the factual condition. So now, let us move a bit ahead. I think Vishal has discussed one judgment, Eicher Motors. A small comment on that. Is it a right or a benefit? In this light, I think he has discussed this. But how to use it into the GST scenario? What was the facts of the case? Let me tell you. Then I'll tell you the how to use this particular judgment in the GST scenario or where we can try to use it. See, what happened
members, it seems there is a disruption again. We'll just connect with Jatin sir again and we'll come back. Just give us 2 minutes, please.
Sir is trying to join in a minute.
छोड़ दो ये वाला मोबाइल ही छोड़ दो। हेलो, इज इट ऑडिबल?
यस सर
ऑडिबल
है सर। अगेन
नो प्रॉब्लम सर, यू कैन कंटिन्यू
सर। इट्स ओके, वी नो यू आर ऑलरेडी जॉइंड फ्रॉम जयपुर एंड विशाल इज आल्सो फ्रॉम नासिक, सो दिस टाइप ऑफ यू नो हिकअप्स पीपल आर यू नो एब्सोल्युटली देयर इज नो इश्यू।
सो ओके, सो सी आई वाज डिस्कसिंग आइशर मोटर्स। सी व्हाट हैपेंड इन आइशर दैट पर्टिकुलर टाइम, Rule 57F was inserted in the Rule 57, sub-clause 4A, if I'm not wrong. Then impact of that rule was that already availed credit was going to be lapsed. This is what in sum and substance the issue. Fine. Now, if you are going to quote this particular judgment in cases whereby there is a difference in 2A, 2B, or maybe supplier has not paid the taxes, then I think it will not be correct situation. Why? Because the fact of in the Eicher Motors were that it was already availed credit, whereby whether the supplier has paid the correct taxes or not, we are examining this aspect for the purposes of availment. So factual situation is different. So I think we cannot apply Eicher Motor in this scenario, number one. Number two, let us try to find out some of the places whereby this has happened. This can be helpful in GST. See, you all are well versed with the real estate taxation, and Mumbai is a hub. With effect from 1st April 2019, whole of the taxation of the real estate got changed. And how it got changed? There were a couple of notifications were there, which were issued on 29th March 2019, which came into effect with effect from 1st April 2019. And effect of the notification were starting from the 3/2019 CTR, that the whatever credit was already availed by the taxpayer was going to be reversed. What was the, they have given a particular formula and said, okay, now you will have to reverse this much of the credit in light of these notifications along read with rule 42 and 43. Amendments were there also for the purposes of this particular aspect. So now what happened, the Aisher scenario and this scenario is, you will see that more or less similar kind of things are there. That one rule has been introduced, and that rule has required to reverse the input tax credit, which has already availed. In that context, the Supreme Court said that input tax credit is a right. What is right? Right under Article 300A, which the Siddhartha Enterprises uses the term, that it is a right to property, because availed credit is a right. But while you are examining whether credit should be available or not, whether it is available to be availed, I think Aisher is not the perfect case. So it is very, very important that you read the ratio carefully, identify the ratio, and in light of the particular facts of the case. Now let me come to another judgment which I just I'm coming into my mind, which I should discuss. Anand Swarup Mahesh Kumar. This is another celebrated judgment of the Supreme Court. See, let me tell you what is the issue in the GST first, then how this case can be helpful for us. I'm sure most of you must be having a clients whereby the clients are dealing in automobile dealerships, maybe two-wheeler, maybe four-wheelers. And what is practice in this particular industry? That normally vehicles are being sold to the customer, and customer is concerned with the on-road prices. They give you a breakup that this is the X showroom price. X showroom normally includes GST. So this is what X showroom price. Then there is a RTO charges. Then there is a insurance charges. Then at times some logistic or handling charges are there. Maybe some etc. additional things are there. Now what happened? At times, more specifically in Maharashtra, the cases were being made under the VAT regime that this particular charges, maybe RTO charges, insurance charges, which are being recovered by the dealer from the customer, should be added to the value on which VAT is to be levied. Technically, this term was there in most of the VAT Act as sale price, and it was turnover was some of the sale prices. So sale price was defined, just like in GST, this section 15, it used to be sale price term was defined. And sale price used to define in a manner like section 15 only. And there was a specific inclusion in that particular definition that any amount charged for anything done in respect of sale of goods, and that is that too at the time or before delivery thereof. This kind of language used to be there in each and every VAT law. So using this particular provision, many cases has been made in the pre-GST era under the VAT regime that VAT should have been charged on this particular price as well. That is GST, that is insurance and RTO amount. Now what happened? The similar things has started in GST regime. At many places, the notices has been served to the automobile dealers that you please pay GST on this RTO amount and insurance amount which you have recovered from your customer. And the reason is again same. Please go to section 15, subsection 3, clause C of the GST regime, of the GST law, which says, 15, subsection 2, clause C, which says transaction value shall include this, clause C, incidental expenses, that means to say this is etc. Then it starts. And again, the same line is copied from the VAT Act. Any amount charged for anything done at the time or before the delivery thereof in relation to supply of goods or services or both. This is what the terminology written in section 15, subsection 2, clause C of the CGST and its respective state GST law. Now, let me tell you one specific thing. When we say that this amount should be included, please refer section 15, subsection 1, which talks about that the transaction value will be the value for the purpose of charging GST shall be the transaction value. Transaction value is defined to mean
the price paid or payable for that particular supply. When the money is the sole consideration. So basically, law wanted to convey, then if there is a consideration that is only money, then whatever price is there for that particular supply of goods or services, then that only will be charged, treated as a value. Now, what is consideration? Consideration is again defined in Section 2, Subsection 31. Here comes rule of this judgment, which I am telling you from the Honorable Supreme Court. They say, whenever there is an amount for which liability is on the buyer, there is a statutory liability on the buyer to pay, it cannot be treated as a part of consideration. It cannot be treated as a part of consideration itself. Let me tell you the brief background of the case. As you all are aware that what used to happen in the pre-GST era, there used to be levy of excise. Then after excise, it was VAT on the total amount of this particular aspect, excise duty come basic value. Now what happened in one of the cases, the agriculture produce were being sold from the market, from the mandi, APMC mandi. So you know that the mandi, at times some places it is called as mandi fees, at times some places it is called as mandi tax. That was also being charged. So assessing officer under the VAT law raised the issue, made a case that VAT should be paid on the basic value sale transaction plus mandi tax as well, or mandi fees. So this type of scenario was there. So in that case, they have examined the respective law, APMC law, whereby the court found that liability to pay mandi tax was not on supplier. Liability to pay mandi tax was on the recipient. As per statutory provision, ultimately it has to be borne by the buyer. And if it is so, if it is passed through the seller, it cannot be said to be consideration or consideration for the seller in respect of supply of that particular goods. Exactly similarly, if we go by the GST law, in the provisions in the GST law, in my humble opinion, the same judgment can be squarely and directly be applied that it won't go ahead with it. Now, let me move ahead on some different cases which I have in my mind. Well, let's come on the valuation aspect only. See, there is one lovely judgment, namely Southern Motors. It was of a January 2017 judgment, just before GST bill were produced in the parliament, just before them. What happened? Again, let me introduce the issue under the GST law, which I want to address. Again, let's take the same industry, automobile. It is a prevalent issue of automobile and actually a general issue for all the different industries as well, wherever there is a distribution network is there. See, we all know what happens. Let's say there is a manufacturer. Manufacturer has sold something to wholesaler. Wholesaler has sold something to further to retailer or then to consumer. This is what a typical chain. Maybe this chain at times, maybe of a 5 or 6 layer. At times, maybe of a 2 or 3 layer chain itself. So let's our example. Let's discuss in today's session. Let's take 3-tier structure only: manufacturer, then trader, then ultimate consumer. Manufacturer gives a target to the trader, to his distributor, that okay, if you'll lift so much of the quantity, then I'll give you this much of the discount. This is very common in nature. We all normally call it as a offtake discount or maybe turnover target, something like this. That whatever quantity you are going to purchase from the seller in a particular period of time, according to that, there will be a discount in terms of this particular If we have a GST impact into it, if we just want to check GST impact, section 50, subsection 3, clause B comes into picture, that this discount is as per terms of the agreed terms. That is why it should be this should be reduced from the valuation on the value on which the GST is supposed to be paid, and accordingly it has to be reduced. No problem. Now let us consider a different scenario, different type of discount, which is bone of contention in GST. Manufacturer has sold some items to the distributor. Distributor is selling to the consumer. And manufacturers comes up with a scheme that, okay, in this Diwali time, whosoever will buy this particular product, we will give a discount of 20,000. Let us say what happens in Diwali time in the, let's say, automobile industry. Okay, Diwali discount. Please mind, the deal is already concluded between the manufacturer and the distributor. Stock is already there with the distributor. But now what going to happen? Now manufacturer is announcing, okay, at this Diwali time or at this New Year time, whosoever will buy will give you a special discount of 20,000 rupees. Or maybe they'll come up a scheme, okay, we are giving up a specific scheme of maybe 50,000 rupees. Now please recollect what happened. There was a specific circular in the GST regime, circular number 105, which was issued. Earlier, there was a circular, namely circular number 92. Circular 92 came up and they described and explained and clarified a couple of things. After that, circular number 105 came. And that particular circular, if I'm not wrong, clause number 4 of that circular, 4 or maybe 5, they have specifically discussed this type of scenario, this type of schemes. That a the dealer is selling that particular product at a lesser price and he's going to get compensated from the manufacturer. So that circular stated that this is nothing but a part consideration is getting received from the manufacturer. That is why the tax will be charged on a whole of the price. Let me explain it through your numbers. Let's say there was a car. Standard price is 10 lakh rupees. At the time of Diwali, company comes up with a scheme that, okay, if you'll buy this car at this particular time, the 50,000 discount will be there. So ultimately, consumer is going to pay 9,50,000 rupees. But circular said, no, you need to pay tax at whole of the 10 lakh rupees because 50,000 you are going to get it reimbursed from the manufacturer itself. Now, in this aspect, you need to understand what is discount. Is it a some separate services which are being provided by the distributor to the manufacturer? Or it was nothing but a transaction, maybe impact of the original transaction. So now let us come up with that judgment, Southern Motors, 2017, January ka judgment hai. If I'm not wrong, 98 VST. See, in this particular cases, the Honorable Supreme Court has discussed the aspects of discount in great detail. They have specifically discussed that how a discount is being given in the industry. They have taken a scenario or the facts which were there in front of them were like the manufacturer used to invoice all its dealer on a fixed number, fixed price. Then used to give the credit note as per their performance. Because he wants to maintain similar scenario, so kind of catalog price was there, and on the same catalog or MRP price kind of thing, they used to give an invoice. And please mind, in the VAT law, this is a judgment under VAT law, and at that VAT point of time, a provision like 15.3 was not there in the statute book. Rather, statute books is specifically, law is specifically used to say that ex post facto discount shall not be allowed to be reduced from the invoice. In those particular legal situations, Honorable Supreme Court analyzed that what kind of discounts can be there. then they have discussed this. One can be a cash discount on the immediate basis you have given it. And one can be a trade discount. And thereby the situations along with this, and you may refer the Advani Oricon as well. This particular aspect was discussed that discount, trade discount, may be in the form of offtake discount. Like, okay, the transaction between the manufacturer and distributor, and further gone ahead, that how ultimately the distributor is going to sell it. If that means a target kind of discount, that how you will sell in the ultimate market, that may also be the situation on the basis, on the context, on the basis of which a discount can be offered. And once discount is as per understanding of the pre-sale, in that case, it cannot be said to be part of the consideration. Hence, it will have to be reduced from the valuation ultimately. So in my humble opinion, the same provision will apply here. And the discount, which is the hue and cry as of now in the GST. So many, I'm sure that you must be, each and everyone will be having these type of notices, cases that department want to tax. Because see, the, what is the understanding of the department? Whatever P&L account you are having, whatever income, okay, just pay the taxes. Just because someone has a different accounting system, there cannot be any tax. Tax is only, you know, only on supply. Tax is not on income. We need to grasp this aspect. So is there any supply? Answer is no. Is there any separate contract for the supply? Something from distributor to the manufacturer? Answer is no. It is nothing but the adjustment of the goods which has already been sold. Correct value, coming to the correct valuation of the goods which has already been sold. Now let me come to next aspect. NM Goyal, I think Vishal, you have discussed.
Yes, sir. NM okay, Goyal fine. Is discussed.
Okay, India Cement.
No, sir. Please, sir. Fine. So I think that is your pet subject, so I have kept it for you, sir.
So let me put again a very, very interesting situation. See, so many hue and cry we have seen in the service tax regime and in the GST as well. And there is a latest development again from the, I would say, in the last GST council, they have discussed a very innovative thing. Payment of GST on royalty. Payment of GST on mining royalty. We all know that the tax rate was amended with effect from 1st January 2019. Earlier, it used to be like the rate of respective mineral would be levied with effect from 1st January 2019. That they have changed it to flat 18%. But now they come up with a kind of clarification or their view. I will not say law. That this rate, due to these reasons, this rate, the intention of levying the tax on mining royalty is at 18% from the day one, that is from 1st July 2017. This is what they come up with a clarification. So ultimately the issue is the payment of GST on royalty. The royalty on account of whatever of they have paid to the respective state governments. The point is whether royalty itself is a payment of royalty itself is a consideration for any kind of supply. What happens? A person, let's say, has been allotted a mining lease by the department. Now he's supposed to pay royalty as on the basis of how much minerals he has excavated and removed from those mines. One mine holder is supposed to pay GST according to that. And if the excavation is not there or below with the limit which is prescribed, in that case, there is a dead rent under Section 9A of Mine and Mineral Development MMDR Act. So issue is, which raised in the service tax regime as well, whether this royalty itself is a consideration for any services or not. Because if it is consideration for the services, what is service? Granting of mineral right. If it is service, and then only we can say this is a consideration for the service. Whereby a view gets propounded that royalty is nothing but a tax. Royalty is nothing but a tax. This aspect was discussed by the Honorable Supreme Court in the seven judges bench. Seven judges bench gets constituted in tax matter rarely. In the case of India Cement versus State of Tamil Nadu, whereby the State of Tamil Nadu has levied some surcharge on the royalty. So the conclusion of that judgment was that since royalty is a tax, there cannot be any surcharge on the tax. There cannot be any further tax on the tax. This was the conclusion of this judgment. Let me go through with the small history of this particular issue. Then what happened thereafter, because earlier there were different conflicting judgments. After this India Cement, this royalty aspect was getting freeze. But what happened in the case of Kesoram Industries, once again, this aspect was popped up. And in the Supreme Court, they have, when they were analyzing this particular judgment of India Cement, they observed that whatever has been concluded by the in the judgment of the seven judges bench of Honorable Supreme Court in the case of India Cement, it appears there is a typographical mistake. It appears there is a typographical mistake. But since India Cement was a seven judges bench, we cannot overrule it. So a request was made to CJI to constitute an appropriate bench. Accordingly, a nine judges bench was constituted to decide the matter once again, whether royalty is a tax or not. And this matter is pending, still pending. This matter is still pending before the Supreme Court. Because, and what is going to happen? What are the consequences going to happen in this case? If ultimately it is finally declared that royalty is a tax, in that case, neither service tax will survive nor GST will survive. On the same analogy, what happened in the when the service tax matter went up to Supreme Court in the case of Udaipur Chamber of Commerce and Industry, again pending before the Supreme Court, that service tax will survive only and only if it is a consideration for some services. So it is again pending on the basis of that judgment. And recently, in the case of Lakhvinder Singh as well, Honorable Supreme Court has given the stay in the GST on the same issue and tagged the matter with the case of Udaipur Chamber itself. Meaning thereby, jo hona hai wo sabke saath mein ek saath flow karega and wait till 9 judges bench order. Two aspects we need to discuss, we need to understand two aspects that what kind of call we need to take on today. Because we don't know when this judgment of 9 judges bench will come and then when it will get applied on the service tax and GST cases. But one clue, or maybe how we interpret the law. I have certain beliefs in this particular line. Number one, and this is what I'm going to tell you. First of all, the judgment of India today, India Cement, given by the seven judges bench has not been overruled, and that is the final judgment till date. There is no conflicting judgment of the equal level or the higher bench. That judgment has not overruled. So as of now, the law of the land is that royalty is a tax. This is what ratio of the India Cement. And when it is a tax, it cannot be said to be for the purposes of some service. though in Udaipur Chamber, Rajasthan High Court concluded that it is a consideration for there is a quid pro quo, and this is nothing but a consideration for services without discussing India Cement. That's why I say Udaipur Chamber was for inquiry in this matter. One aspect that as on today, India Cement is the law of the land. That means royalty is a tax, and this is settled that there cannot be any tax on tax. Second aspect, please go through with the jurisprudence with respect to, if we say, what is a tax? There are a couple of tests are there for that. One of the important aspect is, if the amount direct goes to the consolidated funds of India, this is a tax. And yes, a consolidated fund of India or consolidated fund of its respective state. And yes, royalty amount goes directly in that manner only. This amount has not been kept for any different purposes or any different aspects. Secondly, when we talk about quid pro quo or maybe a contractual arrangement, there are two specific parties. Now you go to the mining law. What it says? The mining leasing being allotted to you, and if you understand the mining policy, the purpose is exploration mainly, prospecting and exploration, then excavation of the minerals. So it is a kind of partnership with the government, I would say, for prospecting minerals. Then excavation comes. And that, in that particular sense, this is requirement of the mining law that you will do this thing. You will file a monthly return. You will get assessed. And if you are not paying the royalty in this line, this much of the penalty will be levied. So filing of the return, payment of the royalty, does it happen in any kind of contract? Happening assessments? In my humble opinion, no. That is why I am of the view that it is nothing but a tax. I think, Dushanji?
Yes, sir.
If you don't mind, काफी मैंने कोशिश करके बोला है, but मुझे थोड़ा सा वो ऐसा feeling हो रहा है, tiredness वाला.
No, sir. Please. Take your call. Final call is yours.
Those judgments are so many judgments are there, and I must say apology from my side actually. I must say that थोड़ा सा mess up हो गया, but yes, Vishal has must have taken good care of it.
Sir, we are doubly advantaged today because we had a very good session from Vishal also, and at the same time, you also nicely sum up and the critical and important judgments and the input from you also was absolutely great.
So my conclusive remark in one line is: whenever you are going through with any kind of old precedent, old judgment of the past regime, please go through with the ratio in light of the facts. If you are not going through with the factual situation of that particular judgment, then probably wo aap andhere mein teer chala. So that maybe boomerang ki tarah wapas aa sakta.
Just copy paste will not work, correct?
Yes, just copy paste will never work.
Never work.
It may work at an adjudication level, but at the higher forum, it will never work.
Absolutely.
With this, I conclude from my side. Any queries are there? I will try to respond from my side.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. First and foremost, we wish Jatin sir absolute good health and well-being, because he was unwell. But in spite of being unwell, I think he has shed some time for our members. We are thankful to him. I would like to ask Bijal Doshi to first take up the questions, and then we take things forward.
Thank you, sir. There's one question regarding that in case of there is no sale consideration received by PWD. still the transaction with PWD is to be considered as same? This question is for Vishal sir, I guess.
I think I answered it at that time itself, because I mentioned that there was a deduction provided in the contract. So there is a consideration. I answered it then and there itself.
Okay, sir. Next question is a bit unrelated, but the person would like to ask that if there are many subsidiaries of foreign entities who are captive services and the Indian entity is allowed as their brand names and also avails the services for head office. However, there is no charge for the same. So can you provide how we need to give treatment of this transaction under GST?
I could not understand the whole of the structuring.
So I'll just repeat, I'll repeat the question as they have mentioned. It's being mentioned as that there are many subsidiaries of foreign entities who are captive services and the Indian entity is allowed to us the brand names and also avails the services for the head office. But there is no charge. I assume there is no consideration. So can you provide your views on how we need to? So it is like related party transaction, maybe covered by Schedule 1. There is no consideration. Then how treatment should be given under GST?
So if it is a related party transaction, as you have already explained, then GST has to be charged on the OMV. You'll have to find out OMV for that purposes. We all know how the OMV is to be computed in a particular cases. And on that, GST has to be discharged.
Okay. One last question is, if an ITC is reversed due to ITC lapsed by notification 20-2018, can we recredit the same based on the Gujarat High Court decision?
In my humble opinion, you can always retake the credit if you have reversed that. There is no restriction in the law in restricting you. Rather, there is a support available within the rules. Rule 37 give you a very good support. Please don't read the margin heading of that. Read the complete rule. It allows you the credit. One. Also, there was a previous question with respect to the PWD cases. I just want to, for the benefit of maybe participants, because they must be trying to plan something in the interest of the client. So I will just suggest them, please go through with judgments of ONGC, which is from Allahabad High Court, Modi Xerox, again from the Allahabad High Court, and Karnataka Power Corporation, which is from Karnataka High Court.
Okay,
they
sir.
Have distinguished the judgment of NM Goyal. NM Goyal is from the Supreme Court, which has declared that this particular issue of the material by the PWD to the contractor is a sale. But again, I will say in a different factual circumstances, not they were similar, but not identical. Some difference were there. So these cases, in these all these cases, which I have explained, which I just told to you, ONGC, Modi Xerox, and the Karnataka Power, in all these cases, Honorable High Courts has distinguished the judgment of NMOA. So if you read those judgments, you will find how to help your client, how you can modify your contract to seek some relief.
Yes, sir. There is no further question. I would like to thank Pradeep sir for giving the opportunity to present vote of thanks to both the speakers. You all will agree with me that in such a short span of time, CA Vishal could have prepared an exhaustive presentation for the members with reference of specific section and rules against each of the case law, which will act as a reference material for all of us in future, specifically case law applicable in case of mismatch of ITC, for which notices are received by almost all of our client. So thank you, sir, for devoting your valuable time. I would like to thank Jatin, sir, for his presence in the session and sharing his inputs on different judgments of High Court as well as Supreme Court with specific legal maxim and legal position taken by court in light of fact of each case and how one should apply practically while advising our clients. Though he is not well today, still he devoted his time. Sir, we wish you speedy recovery and thank you for devoting your valuable time. Within limited time, both speakers presented the given subject in detailed manner and also shared their views on the issues raised by our members. On behalf of BCIC, I request you all to join us to present vote of thanks to both the speaker. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. And Jatin bhai, get well soon. We see you here in Mumbai and physically also. So yes. Please get well soon. Vishal, to you also. Anytime you are welcome. Yes.
My pleasure, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
All.
Thank you. Today's session, guys. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.